attend those sorts of things, that's a doubling of the settlement. If that sort of doubling doesn't affect the character of an area, then frankly I don't know what will. And it's that, to me that falls in the negative side of it, that special circumstances can't be said to have been demonstrated if the impact on, if you like, the living, the people who currently reside in that area, is also detrimental alongside the loss of the green belt. Chair, I don't think special circumstances have been shown to exist in this case. I'm not persuaded by the viability assessment, given that the bulk of it is associated with the communication process, and that the impact on the settlement itself does not outweigh the potential benefits of the hall having two flats in certain village. And for those reasons, having regard to the policy which I was looking at earlier today, I'm happy to move a reason for refusal based on my assessment of the special circumstances have not been met. But all the members may have another view about those special circumstances. I can only put my own view forward.
Thank you, Stuart.
Thanks, Chair. I've got a couple of comments to make. Before I do, can I ask the Highways Officer? The applicant's agent during his presentation said that the applicant or the development would lead to Rest Hill Road, which we are upgrading. I presume the applicant meant the agent meant the applicant is upgrading Rest Hill Road. Or can the Highways Officer expand on that a bit more? Because what was meant by that statement?
So if I can refer you to condition 25 on page 68, as part of this proposal that was to be approved, there's an existing access onto West Hill Road, which would be closed up, and a new access onto West Hill Road would be created. And I think in terms of where that is, on the drawing, it's along the far right of the drawing on the on the screen there, where the red edge extends towards the edge of the drawing.
Thanks, Chair. I can just come back with a couple of comments then. The agent made a comment, and I think Councillor Williams, halfway through his remarks, mentioned the fact that he is the council's heritage champion. And clearly a building in terms of Stoughton Hall is clearly within his scope, if you like. Reading the report, this building has been a listed building for 55 years, reading the report, if that's correct. Now, the Councillor Williams made various comments about the condition of the building, as have a number of colleagues. It seems to me that Historic England, I think we are putting too much weight on the views of Historic England, who 55 years this building has deteriorated, and certainly on any measure, Historic England must be one of the ineffective funders we have in this country looking at this particular building. Now, what I would take exception to, and I'm in no way being personal here, but the agent acting for the applicant made a comment that if we refuse this application, we as an authority will be letting it fall into ruin. Chair, I think the responsibility for maintaining this building is with the owner of this building. It's not a So if a building that is on the listed, it has been listed for 55 years, is at risk, that is a reflection of the people that own the building, not the authority. Now, what I would say is, clearly, the building needs work, because none of us want to lose this historic building, but looking at the application, and the comments that Councillor Kelly has made, I don't see that these particular units justify the exceptional circumstances on this building, because, with respect, we've had 55 years to deal with this building.
Thank you. Does anybody else want to speak on this? Steve.
Yeah, I do, what we do on this committee, members of the board, we do study carefully all the information that we can get in front of us. And our own experiences and other things that have happened on the committee do leave it that way. And that's why I was careful, asked the question about phasing, that we ensure that, you know, whatever happened, the upfront priority was stored to Paul. If we are to refuse it, then that will be another matter. So I began to develop in my mind, is this the only option, is this the only game in town? Well, there are other ways. If someone would have a hand in the pocket, that would be another way. Highly unlikely, highly impractical. But I noticed in the past we've refused applications for some commerciality, as I mentioned, a restaurant and issues like that. You look at Hillbark, which is a grade 2 listed building, which actually has developed its own life, but in another form. So are there other ways? Well, yeah, there probably are if someone is imaginative enough and brave enough and invests enough. So my view is very much akin to the application we dealt with in Birkenhead Park, where the building that was to be protected was being financed through the development there. And I finally came to the decision that, in the end, having weighed up the decisions, that I think I did vote against that because it wasn't in my own mind. And actually, in my own mind, I was probably right because not a thing has happened on that site. Not one spade in the ground, not one. All the tarpaulin's still over the building and it's still there. So I am very dubious about promises from developers about what may be and what can be achieved. However, I think still it is that very balanced decision in my mind about protection of a medieval building. As we say, we don't have many medieval buildings on the Riddle. We're protected. It's that balance between, is this a game changer? Is this the last chance to storm off? In the back of my mind, I think it might not be the last chance. I think there might be other things out there able to do that. So I'd be very interested to hear the actual word of the reasons for refusal. But at the moment, I'm edging to be sceptical rather than in favour of.
Okay, Pat.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I've got some comments, but I just get some legal clarification that having read the viability assessment, and it's commercially confidential, therefore we cannot quote any of the figures from the viability assessment. Well, going back to what the initial petition said, I can appreciate the frustration of people who will be directly affected by this application, have no opportunity to study the figures. I've certainly studied them at great length, and I suppose the comments I would make would be that most of the enabling development is to pay for moving the equestrian facility. I think it's important we kind of bear that in mind. Most of the profits generated from the enabling development are there to pay for moving the equestrian facility. Okay, so if the application is approved, and once it's done, then at the end of it, you've got a state-of-the-art equestrian facility. The developer has made a lot of money, I'll put it that way. You've got a restored historical building with no public access, and you've got 31 new houses within the village or within the Greenbelt location. I also attended a site visit, which one of the things that struck me on the site visit was that within the kind of space occupied by the monument and the barn, that's quite a sizable space. And again, I've looked very carefully at the figures that come out of just developing that space. And when I look at them, there's again a significant profit margin, a significant contingency. There is a gross development value, which I think would be enhanced if the wider development didn't actually proceed. So I think there's plenty of scope within that to actually probably generate sufficient funds to pay for the restoration of the barn and the monument. I'll put it like that. I think the applicant has a lot of scope there to work with a much smaller application that would in fact pay for the development. In terms of the comments about Historic England, I just wanted to refer people to the bottom of page 53, because maybe it's just the way I read it, but the way I read it is that English Heritage has stated it will be for the authority to determine whether the proposed development meets the criteria set out, and if so, whether the public benefit of securing the future Stourton Hall outweighs the disbenefits of breaching development planning policies. And they've also stated that they consider that the amount of enabling development does appear to be the minimum necessary to bring the long-standing building at risk back into long-term beneficial use. Now, maybe it's the way the officer has phrased this. I haven't seen exactly what Historic England have submitted, but that doesn't sound to me like we pored over the figures in very fine detail and we've come to this kind of conclusion. And certainly, you know, I can state categorically that the enabling development is the minimum necessary, if that's true, it's the minimum necessary to restore the monument and move the equestrian facility. It's not the minimum necessary to restore the monument, because all of this incorporates moving the equestrian facility. And I think my last point would be that, you know, we are here to encourage sustainable development. I'm not sure how you define that. A lot of people seem to define it in a way that I wouldn't, but I think any reasonable person would look at this as an unsustainable development in terms of its housing, its impact on the greenbelt. There are no facilities. There is effectively no public transport. We are creating 31 new households, which will be completely car dependent. Okay, and that's not what, as an authority, we should be doing. And that's not what our policies suggest that we do. So I've looked at all the figures very, very carefully. I want to reassure the initial petitioner and the people in the audience who are concerned about this, that I at least have certainly pored over them in great detail. I am not at all convinced that what has been put before us is in any way very special circumstances.
Okay, thanks, Pat. I'm going to move back to Stuart then.
I would move that the application be refused for the following reason. The site lies within the green belt, and the development proposal will be in conflict with UDP policy GBT1. The local planning authority does not consider that very special circumstances have been demonstrated in this case, as required by UDP policy GB2 and the draft core strategy local plan policy CS3. To justify overriding Greenbelt policy and the provisions of the National Planning Policy Framework Section 9 protecting the Greenbelt.
Okay, Stuart,
I
move that. Do you have a seconder? Pass. Second that. All those in favour of refusal? That's unanimous. If you want to leave now, we'll just sort of give you a minute to leave, because I know you've been here quite a while. Thank you. the agenda item to 10 as we agreed, we will give that back after agenda item 11. So we're on page 105, and you have a presentation, please.
The proposal is seeking planning for a two-story side and a single-story rear extension. The proposed site is occupied by a two-story detached dwelling, and it is quite unusual in fact that the plot has a curve on the side of the front. The proposed site is a reasonably large plot compared to most of the neighbouring dwellings or shed proposed. The proposed site is advantage to the south of the site, which is joining the neighbouring dwellings. Neighbouring dwellings damaged by shed proposed. The existing dwelling has a small side conservatory. The proposed dwelling has discussed will demolish the existing conservatory and erect a two-story side extension to accommodate a kitchen garden, ground floor, and a new bedroom dressing room on the next floor. The proposal also includes the erection of a single-story roof extension that will enlarge the garage to create a store, gym, and utility room. The second floor of the two-story extension set back the first floor by 1 metre to increase the distance between the extension and the adjoining properties along Campbell Drive. The ground floor will be in line with the existing dwelling, and the existing extension projects 4 metres into the private garden area of the dwelling. It's 6.7 metres in height and 4.8 metres to the eaves. As part of the development, the internal layout will be altered to create an additional bathroom. An additional bathroom where bedroom 2 only is. And should members be minded to approve their scheme, a condition for its short glazing will be imposed. In addition, as the new first floor window will serve as a dressing room, this will also be conditioned to be fully glazed, thus improving on the current overall situation. The single story extension infills the area behind the garage. The overall height is 3.5 metres to the ridge and 2.5 metres to the eaves. The extension sits off the rear wall boundary by at least 100 metres. In terms of the separation distances, the two-story side extension does not meet the council's usual separation distance guidelines of 14 metres window to wall. It's 12 metres from the 55 Avenue Drive at its closest point, which is the closest residential dwelling. As the extension follows the line of the existing dwelling, the setback of the first floor, the proposed scale is not deemed to result any further direct detriment to the residential community. The proposal was not considered to have an adverse impact on the amenities which occupiers of the name of properties can reasonably expect to enjoy in terms of loss of light, privacy or arbor. The proposed dwelling is not considered detrimental to the character of the proposed dwelling or the wider scrutiny, and is acceptable in terms of scale and design, complies with the provisions of policy cases 11 and the provisions of the National Plan Policy Framework.
Thank you very much. Is the Lord Councillor here to speak on this? If you could just take me. Members, I'm speaking on behalf of the neighbours to Three Shepherd House, who do feel very strongly about the impact this development would have upon their own enjoyment of their properties. They contacted me to help, and two of them have written you two letters now, and also supplied some photographs to help you to put the plans in context. I know you have a busy agenda, and I just want to draw out a few of their points. If you look at the plan on the front page of your report and consider the orientation of the properties relative to each other, and in fact there's a plan within the application, A552LP, designed in more detail, you can see that the boundary is not parallel to the dwelling, and the two houses are not parallel to each other. And this must mean that the extension draws closer to the house behind than the existing house over here. At the top of your page 108, we read that side extensions should not affect the enjoyment of sunlight and daylight. Well, the people who live at in Hamilton Drive will tell you, and people who live tend to know what their own garden's like, that they disagree with that assessment about the loss of sunlight, and they've written to you in their letter to say, as the rear of our houses face west, the reduction of light will be greatest in the second half of the day, when we are more likely to be in the garden. The path of the sun travels around the front of three shepherd posts, which is situated directly behind our properties. As such, it causes a physical barrier blocking the path of sunlight, particularly to 55, through the early to mid-afternoon. The sunlight only returns to the rear of 55 from mid to late afternoon onwards, as it travels past the bulk of the existing house. The proposed two-story development would dominate the open space in which at present we will receive sunlight and create a physical barrier to the sun, leaving 55 in the shadow. Members, SPG is 11, says that 40 metres is the distance. And you can understand why the residents are puzzled that it's acceptable to make a further bit of dwelling and have that only 12 metres. It may be acceptable, but it still doesn't meet the 14 metres, which is in the policy. If approved, this extended dwelling would extend completely along the boundary of the 55 Hamilton Drive. Members, I know it's late, but I would ask you to question the officers on the report before you. Take a look at the plans and decide whether you think this would not close in the aspect between 55 and 57 Hamilton Drive from there, making the houses feel hemmed in, depriving them of the open aspect and sunlight they currently enjoy. I'd ask you to give consideration to the view that this is an unneighbourly development which is too close to the nearby houses, depriving them of sunlight and dominating their view. I'd ask you to remove the refusal.
Thank you, Wendy. I'm going to open this up to committee and comments. David?
Yes, thank you, Chair. This was one of the three site visits we had on Tuesday, which on the face of it looked as though it was trivial, but when we got there, it was well worth having the site visit. Can I have a question that I've just briefly asked the officers? One of them is, how large in terms of footprint size is this extension relative to the existing building, less the conservatory? Interesting to know what the increase in size is, because it seems to be quite substantial compared with the size of the property. I think the first issue that I had was concerning the dominant effect of this property on number 55. That struck me straight away as being a situation where we were creating not only a reduced separation distance, which is not in our own guideline, and should we be encouraging things that fall beneath our own expectation and guideline process, and secondly, the overshadowing of that particular house on 55 by the proposed extension would, in my view, be pretty unacceptable. It takes away all the amenity value that 55 has been entitled to enjoy for the length of time that that house has been built, and would create a very dominant aspect to number 55. So, having initially thought this wasn't a major problem, going on the site visit made me realise that there was a problem. So I'd be interested to hear what others have to say, but I do have wording for a reason for refusal, if and when others have had a chance to comment. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. David Pass.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I also went on the site visit, and I would agree it was very useful. What struck me was exactly that point, that when you looked at the impact on it, it's number 55 behind the property. It is apparent that this development will have a significant impact on that. Now, I think that the least that the residents of 55 could expect is that the development would meet the separation distances. Given that it doesn't meet the separation distances, I think we're perfectly entitled to refuse this application.
when we went on the site visit, you're right, when we looked at it from the road, it did seem trivial. It didn't seem as if it was going to have an impact on anyway. It was like a normal application, a small extension on the side. It wasn't until we went into the dome that we saw other aspects of the proposed light source. And I had a walk around the side to try and judge it from the house, so it was affected. And I could see the point they made. But having said that, no matter what angle you look at it, it is more or less a very built up residential area, notwithstanding the point that they made on the separation side of it. It is the houses, a lot of the houses I think are quite close together anyway. I don't understand the technical side of it. Maybe somebody can explain on that, the other separation aspect, on how that fits in.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. It's quite a constrained site, and the properties are quite close by. SPG 11 is gardens, so it's not actual policy as such. So we'd look to get 14 metres with those towards. In this instance, we're getting 12, but still, I think if you were to push the extension back by a further 2 metres, you'd probably still have the same sunlight issues as you would with this proposal, and it would accord with those guidelines.
Like some other members of the Commission, Chair, I tend to lead the site visits, and you know, with these kind of applications, you kind of worry that neighbour is being assessed against neighbour. But I think in this case, it's one of the quirks, obviously, in the layout of this particular development, that there is a large space to the side of one property. The current occupier has, you know, for reasons, perfectly legitimate reasons, decided they want to try and develop. But I think to pick up on Councillor Hackett's point, I think because it is quite a densely residential area already, I think to make it more densely occupied and to go against the guidance, and you know, I accept the point that it's guidance, not mandatory, but it's guidance for a reason. And certainly I believe that whatever the guidance is, if it's guidance, we need to try and follow it, unless there's clear reasons as to why not to. And I don't see the reasons why the separation distances in this case should be cast aside, if you like, simply because of the location of this extension. So I'd be interested in the planning officers, if they have any view as to why the separation distances don't apply in this case. Otherwise, I'd be interested to hear what the colleagues have to say.
Okay,
well, yes.
I think the question was asked about the size of the building.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, in terms of the size of the building, the existing conservatory is 2.8 metres by 4.5, and at its highest point it's 2.5 metres. And the proposed extension will be 4 metres projection out into the side garden compared to 2.8, and it will be 7.7 metres wide, so just shy of the existing property. And so the ridge of the roof is going to be 6.7 metres in height, so it is quite a bit.
Chair, if I can come back for a moment, I'm really trying to compare the footprint of the existing development in square metres or square yards compared with the footprint of what is quite a large two-storey extension. Maybe you can't provide that information.
Yeah,
I apologise for asking it. But my concern is, as my colleague Gary Lewis has said, should we really be, when this has already got a problem, this house, in terms of a potential loss of light, should we in those particular instances be not compliant with our own guidance? I mean, that's why the guidance was brought out, to prevent that situation in general terms on small congested estates, and we seem to be just flying in the face of it, and this is a prime example of where we shouldn't be flying in the face as far as I can see. But Chair, again, I'll wait to see if anybody else has comments, otherwise I'm prepared to move refusal.
Only a small point, but my view would be, I think we can't be demanding the inspector. If the inspector comes to the same judgment as our professional planning officer, in that even if the guidelines were met by 14 metres, it would be no more demonstrable harm than this extension. It would be likely to turn over that as a reason for refusal. That's the only thing in the back of my mind, because you know, when you have guidance, you look at the situation on the ground, and as the officer said, even if it was pushed back 2 more metres, the same height, the same dimensions, if be little of a differential effect to what this one is. You know, I remember all that games where no right to light, no right to view, and all this sort of stuff comes into my mind. So I think the officers have given the correct interpretation on this, but you know, see what your reasons for refusing that.
Okay, Ian, I'll take you in
there. Sorry, I just want to point out as to why the separation of distances on this particular application should be cast aside, if you like, altogether. What is the justification of not following the guidance as we have on the board?
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, in this instance, we've just taken a judgment view that the separation distance would be no worse than what's already there. So they're already achieving 12 metres from 55 angle to the rear of the side of number 3 shed post. So this will be no different to what's already there.
Are you okay with that?
Sorry, I don't want to get into the business of arguing about metres here and wherever, but the property that we're looking at, 55 Hamlin Drive, at the moment, the separation distance goes all the way up to number 10 Shepherd Close, I think, because there isn't another property between that corner of 55 Hamlin Drive, right up the way across the road. To say it's only 2 metres, it's slightly disingenuous, well, so with respect, but because we're looking at a 50% increase in the size of the property, you're putting a property there that isn't there at the moment, so the separation distance isn't the same as you're introducing a building where there isn't one at the moment.
The extension, as you say, the extension will be coming out further into the side garden, but we've taken the view that if we were to push it back the additional 2 metres, it would have no more harm than what's already there, because I think the initial concern from number 55 Hamilton is the impact of their garden, as well as from their windows, and what we've done is we've obscurely glazed the windows, so there's no outlook from those windows, and as well as that, we've taken the view that they're actually getting rid of a bedroom in the rear of number 3, and they're changing that to a bathroom, so it will in effect sort of make the existing situation better, just due to the orientation of the houses. Number 55 faces towards number 3, and then there is another window that's, you could say, that looks at the proposed extension, but it will also look past the extension. Still have views into the over the garden and into Shepherd Close, but I appreciate it is a tight site and we're just taking the judgment in this instance that 12 minutes will be accepted.
Thank you, Ian.
Thanks, Ian. David,
I'm going to
move to
you. I can just add one point. I'm not homing in solely on the separation distance. That would be ridiculous. In trying to turn something down purely on the ground of a 2 metre difference between separation distances, I think the whole thing is too big. So my reason for refusal is as follows. The proposed two-storey extension would result in an unneighbourly form of development in that it would lead to overbearing impact of the adjoining dwelling by reason of its size, height and siting, which the local planning authority considers would be detrimental to the amenities which occupiers of the adjoining dwelling could reasonably expect to enjoy. This is contrary to the principles set out in policy HS11. Of the Wirral Unitary Development Plan. So just to summarise, I'm not going just on separation distances, I'm looking at the thing in the round. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, so David Elton has moved refusal. Do you have a seconder? Thank you, Ian. All those in favour of refusal? That's 11. Those against? Okay, then refusal is carried.
Thanks,
Jo. So we can now move to agenda item 11. Which is pages 125 to 122 in your pack. Can we have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. The application site at Eleven Lang Lane is half of a pair of semi-detached properties, three-storey semi-detached properties. The proposal that's before you tonight is to demolish that offered semi-detached property and to erect a three-storey building running south towards Lang Lane. It would join onto the existing house, the remaining house of Three Birkett Road, and extend, as I said, southwards towards Lang Lane at three-storey. The site is within a residential area where flats can be acceptable subject to the relevant policies. This proposal is for 9 flats in a new building on the adjacent to number 3. There's a mix of dwellings in the area, so we have on the opposite side of Lang Lane on the south, there are some bungalows and dormer bungalows. We've got 2-storey terrace properties further down Birkett Road, 3-storey properties including application sites. So there's quite a mix in the area. The design of the building that's proposed, as it extends towards Lang Lane to about 5 metres from Lang Lane, it continues the height and scale of the building at number 3 and number 11. It starts off replicating the building that's already there, so the bit that adjoins number 3 looks like a semi-detached house, and then it's progressively more contemporary as it extends towards Lang Lane, but still keeping features that sort of brickwork, the window detailing, that are part of the original dwelling. As a flat development, it has 9 off-street parking spaces, so that involves some on the Birkett Road frontage, 4 on that side, and 5 on the Lang Lane frontage, which involves taking down some of the existing sandstone wall. Our policies require a third amenity space, third of the whole site to be used as amenity space, which this does achieve. So it has parking, it has amenity space. We feel the design is a measure of the building that's already there. Taking into account the differences in height, because Lang Lane, where the application site is significantly higher than Birkett Road, it rises up towards Lang Lane. So the development meets all the interface distances, taking into account, with the exception of one interface distance, which is from the front of the new development, towards number 2 Birkett Road. As we saw at the site visit, that property has a number of windows on the frontage. One of them would be facing one of the new windows, two of the new windows, the development, as the first and second floor bedroom window. Although this is substandard at 17 metres, we won't expect 21 metres. Again, because the existing house is already 17 metres away from the opposite side of Birkett Road, and many of the properties further down are much less a distance to each other, we didn't feel that this in itself was enough to justify refusal. The remainder of the windows that are on the frontage of Birkett Road overlook the garden, number 2 Birkett Road, at a distance which is well within the normal parameters of acceptable. So the application for the residential area, it meets most of the policies except for interface distance, and we are recommending it for approval on that basis. There is a qualifying petition.
Okay, is the petitioner here for this application?
No petitioner.
Sorry?
No petitioner.
No petitioner here? No. Okay, is there a ward council would like to speak on this?
Councillor Geoffrey Watt, West Kirby and Thurston Ward. Thank you, Chair, and thank you to the members who attended the site visit on Tuesday. For reasons of highway safety and audibility, the visit was largely conducted within the gateway to the southwest corner of the site, but on reflection, the proposal might have been better envisaged on opposite the corner of Birkett Road. With this in mind, I would ask for the artist's impressions on pages 7 and 8 of the design access statement to be displayed on the screen, if that's possible.
I can't access the internet to show that, I'm afraid, but I have got plans of those development elevations which I can put on the screen.
Could I just pass round then the two relevant pages?
Thank you.
Okay. As you are aware, there is a petition of 130 signatures and 70 letters of objection. Residents are supportive of the reuse of this site for residential development in accordance with the local and national policies, but they believe it should be on a much smaller scale than this proposal, respecting the character of the area and with adequate amenity space. I do not consider the sufficient weight has been given to the scale and mass of the proposed structure within an area largely developed with two-storey semi-detached dwellings with gable roofs and small terrace cottages. The National Planning Policy Framework places great importance on development being a good design, stating that good design goes beyond visual appearance and includes development responding to local character to ensure the integration of new developments into the existing environment. This proposal is clearly an incongruous and uncharacteristic model of development, more suited to city-based urban design than the suburban loose form of development that has evolved within the neighbourhood. Members may not be aware, although it is reported under item 15 of this agenda at the foot of page 140, that within the last month, permission has been granted under delegation to the same applicant for two detached houses on another site at the entrance to Lang Lane. This proposal is far more in keeping with the local area and retains the entire sandstone wall by using the existing gateway to access both properties. The nearest apartment development at 7 Lee Road of Darmond Green respects the height of adjacent properties and the existing building line being set back from the road with front and rear landscaping and ample parking space, allowing vehicles to enter and leave in forward gear. In terms of scale, the six apartments in Lee Road occupy a plot of more than 1,100 square metres, whereas this plot in Lang Lane measures under 700 square metres for 9 flats. This considerable difference in terms of density should indicate that the bulk of this proposal does not reflect the character of nearby developments and should be considerably reduced in mass. Members attending the site visit will have witnessed that car parking is already at a premium, and that at a time of day when many residents would have been at work. They may also have seen the walking bus footprints painted on the footway inside of the Birkett Road Junction. This is indeed a busy route to three nearby schools and a day nursery in Lang Lane itself. West Kirby Football Club is located opposite the other end of Birkett Road and holds twice weekly car boot sales as well as coaching and matches for all age groups. This creates significant traffic using these roads, leading to a scheme for junction protection in the lines currently under consultation. Most of the properties in Birkett Road do not have off-street parking, and the creation of direct individual access to spaces on this proposed development will inevitably reduce the availability of on-street parking, whilst increasing the demand for spaces beyond the unrealistic requirement of a maximum of one space per flat without even providing for visitors. I am informed that the car parking spaces, as shown, appear to be unachievable given the difference in levels between Lang Lane and Birkett Road outside number 3. Either the spaces of Lang Lane would have a gradient of 1 in 5, or the living rooms would have their windowsills with pavement level, or the roof levels would need to be higher than those existing, making the building even more dominant and with consequences for the separation distances. This conundrum must not be left to negotiation after a grant of permission by relying only on proposed condition 5. Very little amenity space appears to be factored into this proposal, proving this scheme will set precedent for other developers. The development involves considerable loss of permeable ground space, which the authority has an obligation to protect and mitigate against such loss. It has been admitted that some separation distances cannot be achieved, but this is dismissed as no worse than existing. This should not be accepted, as the upper stories of this proposal include habitable rooms likely to be used more intensively than the previous attic rooms.